going to give you a sort of brief overview of what we do at PolyU in terms of the discipline specific courses, but then Caleb will talk about one of our specific courses. So we have around 30 courses. So some of them are workplace professional focused courses, some of them are academic courses as well. Mostly taken by students in usually their third year, but it could be their second, third, or fourth year. So usually students would take just one discipline specific course. So I'm quite amazed that they do more courses at UST. Typically 2 to 3 credits. However, we also have these embedded subjects, which I'll talk a little bit more about later, which is kind of a new challenge for us. So I guess our provision is quite varied, and it really just depends on the department. So in terms of the workplace courses, these are some examples. These are the kind of assessment types we do. So these are the most common ones: proposals, reports, emails. Recently, more focus on kind of like pitch presentations, pitching an idea, same for the proposal. So I guess recently, a bit more of a shift towards kind of persuasive communication. So really the aim is, the transferable communication skills that they can take to the workplace. So we have the same issues that was mentioned yesterday by Simon and Laura about to what extent our courses transferable in the workplace. Will they actually be doing that? But we try to pitch it, not in terms of their learning a text type, but pitch it in terms of the communication skills that they can apply to different genres once they're in the workplace. So we also have the academic focused courses. So we've got some examples over there. So you'll see that I guess there's more of a writing focus and more variety in terms of the types of writing we do. I think that's just because these courses are negotiated with the department. So we do have the more kind of traditional, like genre, discipline specific stuff, but recently also a little bit of a shift towards more kind of general audiences. Okay, so finally I'll just talk about our embedded courses. So recently at PolyU there's been a kind of move to reduce the workload of the students, basically empty out the timetables a little bit, and of course, departments, they don't want to get rid of their own courses, so they kind of come knocking on our door. So we've actually got 11 embedded courses at the moment. These are a little bit tricky. I mean, if you look at the literature, then they say a lot of positive things about embedded courses. These are courses that usually run within the host course. For us, there's usually like one credit, but it could be less. So it's a 3-credit course, we get one credit. So I think the main issue for us is the relationship with the department and exactly what they want. So sometimes the course is actually integrated into the department course, whereas other ones, it's kind of almost like 2 separate courses. We do the language part, which has our own assessments. They do their bit, and there's no communication or regulation. So, this has been a recent thing which has been a little bit tricky for us. Okay, so I think I'll hand over to Caitlin. She's going to talk about one of our ESP type courses.
Hi, I'm the subject leader for English for Scientific Communication, but unlike within that, I live. No scientific background. My daughter is a biologist, if that counts for anything. But yes, anyway, I have taken over this course because about 5 years years ago. Nobody wanted to do it. The woman that did do it had requested, you know, that she was taken on. So I was quite happy to give it a go, and actually I've fallen in love with it. You know, really interesting to listen to what you had to say, Rebecca, about the reading of scientific articles when you've got no background in science. But our course is quite different in a way. It's very much, we get students in doing this course as a discipline-specific requirement, but they come from all different disciplines. They all do the same assessment. So we get them doing two assessments. The first assessment is a group report, which is for a specialist audience. I still haven't fixed it. You know, in 5 years, we played with it. I'm still not 100% confident with it. But I really like the way it feeds in to the second assessment. So they do all this research for the first assessment in a group on a topic that they're interested in. And we try and encourage that to be something current in their area, something new within the last 5 years, something where there's some controversy around the topic, there's a research gap. So they do this report, they do it together with 3-4 students, and then they take that and they do their article for the non-specialist students. So they've got all the ideas, they've done all the research, and then they have to change the audience. So it's much shorter. We try and keep the word limit really short for the second assessment, which is the students' feedback every semester. Is it's too short, it's too short. How do we take 1,200 words and make it into 700 words? Well, you're not just copying, you know, one to the other. So we get some great, you know, like I went to a meeting with the Faculty of Science, and I'll never forget the students complaining to at the meeting about this assessment. And the professor saying to them, that's what you do. If you do any research in science, you feed it to the student. You know, if you find something in science, what do you do with it? You give it to the public. So it's relevant. I'm not sure still about the writing, because it's all writing. You know, I'd love them to have some speaking. We introduced this as, last semester, they did it as a website. So I don't know, you know, at some stage we could put a little bit of speaking in there for them, because at the moment there's nothing. Anyway, that's the course. So the problem, one of the problems, another problem, is moving a bit away from the science, I guess, is that we have a group assessment. And, you know, the feedback from the students is the free riders, but there's also every semester, I mean, I'm the subject leader, so I deal with those students who either they've taken over the whole assessment and written it all by themselves, and then are complaining that others are not contributing. But it's also difficult for the teachers. We're not getting an idea of individual input or being able to assess individual ability. Some of the things we've looked at, we've provided the students with guidelines, we've provided them with videos, we've changed to a bit more of a more flipped approach, and we've introduced a method section in their scientific report to show their responsibilities, and we're making use of Google Docs so we can see. So we'll just have a look at each of those. So there's a couple of examples of worksheets we've given them with video links into how to work in a group. And I think this is, I don't want to change from a group assessment. I've thought about it, I've talked about it to professors, I've talked about it in our department. If you look at any scientific research, it's very, very rare that one person does the research. Usually there's a list, you know, of 10 people doing a piece of research. So, but even if they never work in science, that ability to write together in a group is a real skill. Forget the science. You know, just being able to, you know, I can work with a couple of groups, right? Or maybe two people. And if I get on and we write the same style. But bring in a third person and try and write something together, it is really hard. It's really challenging. I mean, we're fortunate these days that we've got Google Docs to be able to help. So anyway, these are, you know, just worksheets, videos on basically how to form a group, how to allocate different work to do. I mean, it's simple things, like in the first class, giving each other your email. You know, and actually getting them to say, okay, arrange a time, tell me when your group is going to meet. Because they now, face to face, it's unlikely they'll meet. Yeah, there's a couple of videos. And then the flipped approach, we thought that, okay, how to help them work in groups. Well, they can do the how to write the scientific report, like Rebecca was saying, a lot of those things, you know, you can do independently. The sections of a report is basic. So the actual writing of it. So we get them to do quite a few of the activities. This is one of the examples. Before they come to class, another issue. And then when they get into the class, they're actually in the groups. The teacher can facilitate, the teacher can watch them working together in groups, can help them to work together to write their report. We only do this for 4 lessons. So it's just 4 flipped classes. We've only, this is the 7th class. Then one of my colleagues was doing an update of materials, and she found, I didn't know this, but some research reports, they actually put the author's responsibilities. So we've included this in our methods section, in the methods section of the report, in one section. Their method is doing research, and how did they do that, and who was responsible. So they can actually model that on authentic methodology. Well, actually, it's usually down the bottom of the research report. And then, of course, we can see through Google Docs who's doing which section. So if we get issues, I only use this when there's an issue. When a student comes to me and says, so-and-so in the group did nothing, and I don't want them to share our grade, then I can look in the Google Doc and see who's contributed what. So my questions are more about collaborative work, more about group work than science. But if you want to know anything more about the assessments we do, or anything more about the quiz,
I want to know about the grading for the group work, because for our practice, some group work will do one grade for everybody, but some other courses will do individual grades for group members. So how about the grading for
one grade for everybody, but how do you do
the
individual grades?
So there may be a component that they have to do it individually, and we assess them individually, so we have individual grades, so like presentation, so we give individual.
Okay, so they might get share a grade for a,
for the written work.
The written, and then do a little
presentation.
Is the presentation quite small?
Around 10 minutes, and the weighting is about 15 to 20
percent. Okay. Yeah. Okay. That is a really good idea.
Yeah, so yeah. We can read. really check whether there are some free riders during your presentation.
Okay, thank you. Because that's what I like to do, you know, and taking that report and doing a short presentation,
yeah.
They could be an individual component, could be an individual branch. They are only allowed two assessments, so they have to be a component.
I'm just very curious as to the structure of the course, because you've got a two-credit course there, and I suppose that means, because a regular course at Poly is 3 credits, that means it's actually sort of like 2/3 of the regular course there, but you've actually got two different genres that you have to deal with, one for each assessment. So I'm just wondering how you actually, because that's very limited time, I suppose, and also in terms of the contact hours each week, logistically, how
two hours each week.
How do you actually facilitate feed forward actually between the second assessment, which is the specialist report, and the third one, which is actually a non-specialist report? Because that process would be very important. So how do you highlight to them, okay, so when you give them feedback on that specialist one, how do you make sure that it would be quite relevant to their work? I mean,
right at the very beginning.
Right at the beginning.
So right at when they're choosing their topics,
yeah.
Right then is when we talk to them about transferring that, being able to transfer that topic to the general. So most of the time, it's like at the moment, you know, like medical marijuana or alcohol and sperm count. It's like, what's the audience? What's the general audience? Will they be interested if you choose that topic? So right from the very beginning, think about that and talk to them. Choose the topic is essential. It's weighted 50-50. And when I first taught it, it was 60 for the group, 40 for the individual, but it's not really fair to the individual. Student feedback, it goes like this all the time. Yeah. Teacher feedback, it goes like that all the time, so we just keep it at 50-50. So the topic is essential because it carries for both assessments, so it takes time. But we're thinking assessment one and two. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
I really like those kind of assessments that kind of the same kind of content, you know, students have researched, they've been out there trying to find it, but then you're asking them to kind of find different audiences to present those. I mean, I think that's, you know, going back to the how specific should we be, I mean, that's something that transfers well, I think. We often have to write things to different audiences. Sometimes we're talking to laymen, other times we're talking to also lay people. Sometimes we're talking to specialists, and, you know, I think we probably have quite an important role to play to help students see what's different with those different audiences and linguistically what are we doing differently. And so I do like that kind of assignment. I think it's something.
Me too. Me too. It's one thing that I don't want to change. Yeah.
Do the students like it?
Yeah. Most of them.
But see the benefit of changing the audience?
Yes, but some of them we get like it's how relevant is this? Are we ever going to do this? You know.
Great video of your science professor who said, this
"Yeah,
is
I do, I do." Yeah, but I'm only one teacher. I
no,
do
people science professor.
Get a science professor on video.
Yes,
and show it to the students.
Yeah.
We have the same issue with a lot of courses. I think the students don't see it, but then sometimes, you know, if you've got supporters in the faculty, you actually go, "Oh no, actually, that changes students' opinions pretty quickly."
Yeah, good point. Yeah.
We had fourth-year nursing students who basically told second-year nursing students, no, you really will have to do a lot of reflection, this is worth your time, and the nursing professors were saying the same thing. And so the second-year students were like, having moaned to the teachers about why are we doing this. Yeah. There's people in their own faculty who are saying, no, this is really important stuff. And I think that's great if we can work with faculties enough to have them help us sell the idea of why it's important to write for different audiences.
Thank you.